Our host today is a world-renowned magician, speaker, and author. You may have seen him in numerous TV appearances, including CBS's 48 Hours, PBS Nova, and repeat appearances on The Today Show. A skeptical advocate for more than 20 years, he's the co-founder of National Capital Area Skeptics, co-founder of New York City Skeptics, contributor to Skeptic Magazine, presenter at Center for Inquiry, and a longtime colleague of the James Randi Educational Foundation. He can also be heard weekly on the podcast For Good Reason. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our host, Jamie Ian Swiss.
Good morning. Thank you very much. Good morning, NECSS. We are glad to see you. Thanks for being here. Welcome to the second Northeast Conference on Science and Skepticism. For 2 years in a row, we are sold out. Thanks for being here. How many were here last year? Oh, a lot of returns. You must have had a good time. How many first-timers here? Excellent. New meat. Welcome. The Northeast Conference on Science and Skepticism is produced by the New York City Skeptics and the New England Skeptics, a joint production, a one-day conference of science, skepticism, education, critical thinking, all ideas and goals that we share, and we are very glad to have you here today. I am going to get right to it and introduce to you our keynote speaker, and that is truly my great pleasure. This gentleman has long credentials in the skeptic and humanist field, 10 years with the Center for Inquiry, where he concluded as vice president in charge of outreach and in charge of their incredibly successful and effective national outreach program. He has lectured across the country at universities like Stanford, Harvard, Yale, UCLA, etc., on education, science, and belief. He is a former professional magician, and so therefore his intellectual qualifications are sturdy. And as such, he has a special interest in the psychology of belief and how deception and self-deception intersects with that. He was the host of the popular podcast Point of Inquiry, is now the host of the podcast produced in association with the James Randi Educational Foundation For Good Reason, in which you can also hear my weekly commentaries, The Honest Liar. You know, I have to say that despite the frustrations of being a skeptical activist in this world, nevertheless, there are always things that mark progress. There are always things to celebrate. And there have been few things in that world in the past year that I have personally celebrated more than the fact that he has assumed his new post as the president of the James Randi Educational Foundation. That is nothing but good. And even in the short time he has been in that position, at the JREF, there are new initiatives in the area of education, grassroots outreach, publishing, and others. There's new progress in our previous areas there of success, including the world's largest skeptic gathering, TAM, the amazing meeting, which will take place this July, again in Las Vegas, and also, of course, the famous $1 Million Challenge. You might hear some more about those things in the course of the day today. And so it is my great pleasure to introduce to you my friend and colleague, the president of the JREF, DJ Grothe.
Hello, everyone. Hello, thank you. I appreciate that applause. It's just like I rehearsed with some of you to keep going. Thank you. We'll get right started because we are a little late. It is my great pleasure to give the keynote at NECSS this year. I'd like to thank Steve Novella, Paige Van Meter, Michael Feldman, Jamie Ian Swiss, of course, all the volunteers, everyone who's come together to put on this great sold-out event. This, to me, shows the power of independent local groups to advance skepticism. Jamie asked how many of you were here last year, how many of you are here for the first time. How many of you, how many of you is this your very first skeptical event of any kind? Please raise your hand. Wow, I wish you should have looked around. That is amazing to me. That emphasizes my point about the power of local grassroots groups advancing our shared mission, our common values and aims of skepticism, which are what? What are our shared aims, the values of skepticism? Is it to meet and organize so that we can better combat the peddlers of woo-woo, as our beloved James Randi refers to our cultural competitors? Is it a value of skepticism just that truth is better than falsehood? Maybe that's what's bringing us together. Or maybe it's our goal to get together in a pub and revel and have a lot of fun, right? I think a lot of people enjoyed that last night. It was I was disappointed I was not able to make that. Maybe the point is just to get together and rage against all the nonsense, basically to kvetch to ourselves about all the people who believe nonsense when we're smart enough not to. So is that the goal, kind of to get together as cognitive elites, as Christopher Hitchin refers to us sometimes? Well, that brings me to the topic of my talk today, which can be introduced with the question, why are we here? I don't mean that in some existential hand-wringing way, why are we here in the universe, but why are you here today? It's a kind of nice day in Manhattan. There's a lot to do, and yet all of you are here today for a whole day long to listen to people talk about science and skepticism and critical thinking. Are you here because you honestly can't find the answers to the skeptical issues we'll be talking about? I mean, you can't Google them, you can't go to the library. This is your one chance to get the truth on these issues. Are you here just because it's really fun to hang out with our ilk on a Saturday in Manhattan? Maybe you're here because skepticism is your hobby, right? That's ostensibly a good answer for some of us. Skepticism is our hobby. Maybe skepticism to you is like collecting comic books or maybe watching old movies. Just less than a week ago, a JREF staffer expressed to me how much working at the James Randi Educational Foundation had been a deeply meaningful experience to him. It wasn't just another job, he emphasized to me. He told me he has had many jobs over the years, but working at the JREF was different for him. Working at the JREF had been, to use his words, more like a calling. Certainly not something like just a hobby, right? Now, I have tons of hobbies. I'm kind of a geek. My partner, my spouse calls me all the time, my gosh, you're a geek. Go to your geek fun, comic book conventions, etc. I love comic books. That's an example of a hobby that I have. I own thousands of comic books. I'm even allowed to have my own little room in our apartment where I can organize all my thousands of comic books in long white cardboard boxes, also my magic collection, my magic books. I've been to tons of comic book stores all over the country, many comic book conventions. And you know that I've never heard someone who's really passionate about comic books, collecting and reading comic books, even if they're obsessed with comic books, I've never heard anyone refer to their love of comic books as a calling, right? I hear skeptics, honest, use that term frequently. I'm also really into magic, legerdemain. I've been going to magic conventions on and off for 20 plus years. The passion I feel for magic is unlike the passion I feel for skepticism. It lacks a component that my love of skepticism has. Why is that? I submit that you are here today. You've paid a not inconsiderable amount of money to spend the day and listen to folks yammer at you, have a conversation with folks. And I submit that my colleague at the JREF, for whom skepticism is a calling, feels that way, and that my passion for advancing skepticism in society is different than my love of comic books or maybe playing video games on our Xbox 360. Well, all of that doesn't compare to skepticism because skepticism is more than just a hobby, I'll argue. And it's more than just a club. It's more than just a club for our little cognitive minority or for the cognitive elite, for us to all get together and congratulate ourselves about how smart we are compared to the people we think aren't as smart as us. I'll argue today that you're involved with skepticism, here it is, because skepticism is a humanism. And that's the title of my talk today, Skepticism is a Humanism. So let's get into it. I predict that there are going to be some grouchy skeptics hear that title of my talk, Skepticism is a Humanism, and get riled up and ready to kvetch. And that's the point of this conversation. Very simply, let's define some terms. What do I mean by humanism? What do I mean by skepticism? For me, my minimal definition of the word humanism is only that it's a naturalistic, as opposed to a supernatural, ethics focused on human well-being. We're not going to debate about whether or not humanism is broader than that, like can humanism involve duties to non-human primates or the whole biosphere. For the sake of our conversation, humanism is a non-supernatural way of deriving ethics focused on people. Humanism is an ethical way of looking at our duties that some would argue predates Western monotheism, predates the religions, going back even to the pre-Socratics. It's not something some professor invented to counter the religious right a few decades ago. So again, humanism, a set of ethical motivations or obligations that are not posited on belief in the supernatural. They're not derived from belief in the supernatural. They're about the here and now. And just so no one gets off track, confused, so I can communicate this point clearly, I am not saying that skepticism equals atheism or that skepticism is the same thing as secular humanism. Maybe we'll tease out some of those distinctions later in the talk. There are tons of kinds of humanists, in other words. Not all of them are atheists, just as not all of us are atheists or skeptical of religious claims. But even religious humanists, I would argue, derive their ethics. They get their sense of right and wrong from naturalistic, secular reasoning and argument, not from an appeal to supernatural sources or divine command. They look at naturalistic reasons, not supernatural reasons, for being good in the world. And there are many kinds of religious folks who argue about right and wrong without appeal to divine authority. So you even have something Pope Pius called Catholic humanism, which is a discussion of right and wrong without appealing to the Bible, but appealing to human problems right here in the real world. So I'm arguing, my keynote address at NECSS is that skepticism is a humanism. We've defined humanism in this very minimal way. At least for our purposes, it will work. Now to define skepticism, and don't you love that the first conversation you're having with speakers today is to define the S word, right? I want to make a few points about my take on skepticism. First point I'd like to make about what skepticism is, well, at the very least, skepticism, in common usage anyway, right, it's even the way some of us would use the term, is that skepticism is saying no to nonsense beliefs. It's all about knowledge claims, actually about rejecting false knowledge claims. That's what a lot of us use the term skepticism or skeptic to refer to. When someone says, I'm a skeptic, it means they're skeptical of a belief. They don't find compelling evidence to warrant a claim. So that's one sense of the word skeptic. You're saying no to others' beliefs that you find to be nonsense. But I don't think that definition of skeptic goes far enough. I don't think that definition of skeptic that we all kind of use offhand at skeptics in the pub groups all over the country, I don't think it's sufficient. So the second point I want to make about what skepticism is, well, it's that the definition of skepticism I just gave misses the mark. As I said, it doesn't go far enough. I think a better working definition of skepticism is just something like ordinary common sense. If you're going to buy a car, you'll lift up the hood, you'll kick the tires, you might take it for a test drive. You will inquire into the question whether or not it's a good deal. Is it worth the money? And that inquiry is the second sense of the word skeptic that I'm really in favor of. In fact, the Greek word where we get the word skeptic from, skeptikos, merely means to inquire or to find out. It does not mean to reject a claim, to oppose a nonsense belief. It really just means that skepticism is a way of finding things out. It is a method of inquiry. In this way, skepticism is continuous with science, with the methods of science. So that opens up a can of worms. Any skeptics pub gathering or drinking skeptically group or meeting of a local skeptics organization around the country, something people always talk about is what is commonly referred to as the scope question. What is the real purview of skepticism? Well, we've talked about skepticism being at once a rejection of false beliefs and also just a way of inquiring, finding things out, a method of looking into things. I'd argue that this implies, the second sense of the word skepticism implies that skepticism as a way of approaching the world means that it's not just focused on one or another kind of view, but it is able to be broadly applied in many areas of inquiry. I personally do not think that our skepticism should just be limited to the things that go bump in the night, like ghosts and monsters and vampires and chupacabra, right? I think that our skepticism can be widely applied to many domains of inquiry. We all know people who are skeptical in one area of their lives and very credulous, we'd say even gullible, in other areas of our lives. Maybe some of us fit in that category, but we would admit that it's not ideal. So my spouse thinks I'm a great skeptic most of the time, but when you start talking transhumanism and radical life extension, he thinks I'm a little kooky. That's the only conversation I'm not allowed to talk about at a cocktail party, because then it sounds like I'm in a cult. So isn't the goal to be skeptical consistently about everything in order to come up with the best answers about our take on reality, the best and most accurate view of reality? Should we not be skeptical also of ancient received wisdom, so-called, and of possibly outmoded views of morality? Should we not also be skeptical of political ideologies, skeptical of the media? Or do we only want to be skeptics of ghosts and chiropractors, but gullible and open to manipulation and deception in all of these other areas? It's time for me to be very clear about something. While I personally believe in our workaday world that the same toolkit we skeptics apply to ghosts and paranormal and pseudoscientific claims, Loch Ness Monster, alt-med, so-called complementary and alternative medicine, that same toolkit applied to those issues can and should be widely applied to all areas of inquiry, maybe also to consumer products, to the things we hear from politicians and from the media, to a whole host even of economic and political questions, maybe skepticism of our judicial system, our justice system, even skepticism into religious claims. While that's my personal view, I also want to say that organizationally, there's a necessary division of labor. In the organizations that advance skepticism, well, nonprofit organizations are best when they're focused on a limited mission and don't try to do everything. That's my view. And so as an educational nonprofit, the James Randi Educational Foundation focuses on empirical claims that are relatively easy to test, at least easier than debating who's right about politics, right? Or who's right about economics. We focus on pseudoscience and the paranormal and the supernatural because those claims can most easily be tested, the evidence most easily looked at. Everything doesn't just devolve into a matter of opinion. So does Sylvia Brown have a psychic or paranormal ability? That's much more of an appropriate question for the JREF than is Keynes or is it Hayek that's right about the commanding heights of the economy, right? Historically, over the past 35 years of organized skepticism, organizations like PsyCop or Michael Shermer's Skeptic Society have tried to focus mostly on what Carl Sagan calls scientific skepticism in his writings, really trying only to look at testable pseudoscientific and paranormal claims. ESP, ghosts, cryptozoology, chiropractic, homeopathy, that sort of stuff. It's always been up to other organizations that are also skeptical to apply skepticism in other areas of inquiry. Some other organizations focused on applying skepticism to religious claims, others to questions in politics or philosophy or ethics. There was a division of labor, kind of a non-overlapping magisteria in skepticism, that said this group does skepticism on these issues, this group does skepticism on those issues, maybe this group over here is only focused on alt-med, this one on pseudoscience and the paranormal, this one on religion, ethics, and society. But in recent years, the lines have begun to really blur, I think, considerably. Randi and Shermer both came out really strong as enthusiastic brights. Do you remember that? So Randi and Shermer are talking religion, or had been. Shermer has spoken out many times that the scope of skepticism, the skeptical movement, may in fact be too limited. Maybe he suggests a couple times, that the scope of skepticism is a little trivial. Maybe, you know, people have asked how relevant some of the areas skepticism looks at is to our daily lives. Shermer says, how many times do I want to be asked about Bigfoot? All right, let's move on to more relevant, more interesting questions. Incidentally, I find the question of Bigfoot really interesting. So, and cryptozoology in general. So, Shermer has applied the toolbox of skepticism to questions other than ghosts or Bigfoot or psychics. He's looked at the God question. In his books, he's looked at creationism, Darwinism, where ethics comes from. He's applied the same skeptical toolbox to these areas. Most recently, he's even, he says, applied the skeptical method of inquiry to economics, bringing skepticism into economics. He's branching out with his skepticism, and Randi has spoken out increasingly about religion as well. So time will tell if a skepticism interested in these wider questions is going to pay off. But again, I want to say and be on the record that for the James Randi Educational Foundation, we are still limiting our focus on testable claims of the pseudoscience and the paranormal, testable supernatural claims. Okay, so we've talked about what humanism is briefly, brief little definition of humanism. And I've argued that skepticism is not just saying no to other people's beliefs, but it's more affirmative. It's actually a method of inquiring generally, a method of finding things out, that it's continuous with the methods of science. We've talked a little about the scope of skepticism, and obviously that's a conversation that you should always end with the word et cetera, because it never ends in our movement. We've talked about the questions, should skeptics only apply their skepticism to pseudoscience and the paranormal, or more broadly apply it? Now I want to get back to another aspect of skepticism that we have only recently, I think, begun talking about more, and that is what fuels our skepticism. So another aspect of skepticism I want to talk about, well, I'm going to argue that skepticism means something more than just rejecting claims, and even more than just a method of inquiry that can be personally broadly applied. It's not just rejecting claims, it's not even just this affirmative approach to inquiry. Skepticism, I think this is some evidence of it, is also a movement. Skepticism is a movement. It's not just inquiring into claims. Because skepticism for us is not just about testing claims, but also about organizing into groups, discussing these topics together, hopefully doing something about the harm we think that some of these unfounded beliefs cause people, causes people, because we work together to ring the alarm bells and to raise awareness. Because of all of that, skepticism is a movement. So if you're going to ask, what is skepticism, you have to say, among other things, it's a movement. Right now, the skeptics movement is stronger, I think, than it's ever been. There are about 200 local groups throughout North America, by my count, local skeptics groups. Some of these are formally structured with boards and advisory committees and you know, outreach programs and public lecture series. Some of them are really informal meetups, drinking skeptically groups or skeptics in the pub groups. Some of these local groups meet regularly on a monthly basis, like I mentioned, putting on a lecture series or public programs. Others meet less regularly. Some are just discussion groups or coffee clutches or book clubs. A couple groups have grown sufficiently that they can put on phenomenal sold-out events like this without the infrastructure of national organizations with big budgets and professional staff. So there's a lot of diversity among these local groups. All of these groups, every single one of these local groups, and I visited a lot of local skeptics groups over the years, all throughout the United States and Canada and the UK, every one of these skeptics groups feels part of the skeptics movement. They're not just individual little clubs of inquirers. They identify as part of a larger thing called the skeptics movement. There is a common identity that we share within skepticism. There's a real sense of community, a palpable sense of community, I think, is measurable. No matter where you go to Seattle and you can plug into a local skeptics group there and it still feels like your tribe, like your community. You go to Nantucket. I don't know if there's a Nantucket skeptics, but you get my point. Wherever you go, we can find local skeptics who are on our side of the fence, who identify with the movement. So, why is that? Why do we have a shared history that we all identify with? Why do we have our own heroes, our own lore? Well, here it is. I think that skepticism is a movement precisely because it is informed by a kind of humanism. That's my point again. You don't hear people talking about the comic book movement, right? You don't hear people talking about the Xbox 360 movement. But you do hear people talking about the skeptics movement. Movements are inspired by moral commitments, sometimes even by moral outrage, a desire to come together, to organize, to change things, to make things better. Movements are inspired by ideals and values, and the skeptics movement is so inspired. In this specific sense, the skeptics movement is no different than other movements. The skeptics movement, in fact, has that in common, say, with the Tea Party movement, or the abortion rights movement, or, you know, what, the religious right movement, right? In that it has in common a sense of moral duty to organize and do something. Now, obviously, the issues we're doing something about are very different. There's a lot of variety there. But the movement aspect is explained, I think, mostly by the fact that we share values and not just positions on questions. What coheres all of these people, all of these skeptics who meet in all these groups everywhere, what coheres them into a skeptics movement or community isn't just the hobby of skepticism, although skepticism is a lot of fun. It's like a hobby in some ways. You know, some people memorize all the details in baseball, or, you know, all the stats of a hitter or something. Can you tell I don't follow baseball? A hitter. But other people have memorized the 30 or 40 years of skeptics history and can recount for you this episode in Randy's life, or this episode in Martin Gardner, or this thing that Carl Sagan wrote in a chapter or a paper that he, you know, is kind of obscure to most people, right? So we have this shared history. What coheres all of us into a skeptics movement isn't just that it's a hobby. What coheres all of these skeptics, all of us together, is that we get together because there are problems in the world resulting from undue credulity. These are problems in the world that we're coming together to try to fix. Through our skepticism, we're trying to make the world a better place. Doesn't that sound a little grandiose? But that's actually what's going on. We're organizing to try to fix problems. We're responding to an ethical imperative that most of us feel. It's something we express when we rage against a huckster or a charlatan. It's something that makes us, I think, realize it's obvious that skepticism is not just about what's true and what's false, but about what's right and what's wrong. This ethical imperative to do something about the nonsense is, I think, informed by humanism. What I'm really talking about here is a kind of righteous indignation. Skepticism is about what is right and wrong in the moral sense, not just about what's right in the correct versus incorrect sense, the epistemological sense. When we get riled up because a huckster is peddling quack medicine, it's because quack medicine harms people. And we know that it's wrong to harm people. When it comes to, say, pseudoscientific quack theories on vaccines causing autism, well, if you believe that and don't vaccinate your child, you may harm your child. If everyone believes that, we all may be harmed. And we think that that is wrong. It's morally wrong. And if enough people believe that nonsense, well, that harm that results is what motivates us to act. When we rage against Sylvia Brown or John Edwards, keeping people stuck in their grief, pretending to talk to deceased loved ones, and we think it's all just because they're chasing after a buck, when we rage against that, it is because we are ethical and they are not. We want to stop Sylvia Brown because it's an issue of right and wrong, not just because it's an issue of what's true or false. I want to talk about James Randi in this regard briefly. Skepticism for James Randi, I'll say this, I'll argue this point, skepticism for Randi is a humanism. Though he will bristle likely at the characterization, I consider Randi to be a deeply humanistic person, deeply humane. He's tilted at all these windmills all these years. He's the hero he is to all of us and to thousands, countless other people around the world, because he is fighting for the right and for the good, not just that he wants to go around proving everybody wrong and proving himself correct. He's one of the good guys on the side of reason and good sense against the bad guys, those purveyors of the cult of unreason that he and I and many of you, all of you, I bet, round of drinks, but I'm not buying. Well, we reason they're harming people. Randi has taken on fake psychic surgeons. He's exposed fraudulent faith healers who have little receivers in their ear. He's challenged magicians who dishonestly use their magic tricks to inspire New Age mumbo-jumbo belief. And he's tested no end of sham gizmos that purport to do one thing but actually are just kind of a gobble of wires that are not even connected, maybe some flashing lights or something. If you ask him why he has done all of this, all of these years, all of these decades, his answer is simple. He says, well, it's the right thing to do, right? That's Randi's answer. Why are you doing your skepticism? It's the right thing to do. In other words, he feels a moral obligation to be a skeptic, and not one derived, obviously, from supernatural faith commitments. When Randi was a young teenager, I think he was 14 at the time in Toronto, 14 years old, there was a spiritualist church that he wandered into, and he saw a young minister doing a version of a magic trick to inspire belief in the people in the pews. Spiritualism is a religion that, rather than sermons on conduct or sermons on the Bible, the person, the preacher, the minister, receives messages from deceased loved ones, and that's the service. Well, Randi was so enraged as a 14-year-old to see the preacher, the minister, doing a magic trick at church that he knew was just a magic trick, that he marched right up to the pulpit and exposed the fraud right then and there in front of everybody in the spiritualist church. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a deep ethical sense of right and wrong. It's a deep ethical sense motivating that act of skepticism. Of course, you should know that he was quickly arrested. And he had to have his father called off the golf course to come get him at the police station. So skepticism sometimes has a downside, right? If you spend any time with Randy, these kinds of amazing events of his life eventually start coming out of him. His life is one of a kind of skeptical activism motivated by a deep ethical sense of right and wrong. Many of us see a TV faith healer. You know, when I was a kid, I saw Robert Tilton or Benny Hinn or Ernest Angley on TV. Many, many people in society can see that on TV and recognize it as fake or a sham. But when you think being such a false prophet or false preacher is so wrong that you actually dress in drag and show up at his miracle crusade to expose him, well, that's taking it to another level, and that's the level Randy took it to. That's the moral indignation, the righteous indignation that Randy feels, that I argue fuels his skepticism. My talk's not about James Randy, but he's the perfect example of my point. He isn't just in this skepticism racket to go around proving people wrong in an epistemological sense. He's done what he's done all of these years and decades because of the other sense of right, which is right versus wrong ethically. Randy's skepticism is a humanism. For him, skepticism is as much about right and wrong as it is about true and false. So, if we agree that our skepticism is fueled by these humanist or these ethical considerations, this non-superstitious view of right and wrong that compels us to speak out and do something and organize when other people are believing harmful nonsense, well, I want to just touch on how that could actually, I think, sometimes be a little problematic. And then maybe we'll have time for some questions, some conversation. One downside to recognizing that our skepticism is fueled by these ethical considerations, that skepticism is a humanism, is that when you think you're right in the moral sense, and you really believe it, that leads to a kind of moral certitude that can sometimes make some of us a little overzealous in our skepticism. Zealots go too far. They may even be correct on the facts, but zealousness is a problem. I'll explore why. Skeptical zealots, we've all met some over the years. One of my best friends I consider a skeptical zealot. They assume that all believers, all the credulous out there, are either idiots or worse, that they're villains. And that we're always on the side of right and they're always on the side of wrong. Zealotry, especially zealotry and skepticism, is no fun. Been there, done that. I think skepticism is fun, and therefore I want to temper the zealousness just a little. I'm not talking, obviously, about tempering our impulse to go after the charlatans or the frauds. I really buy the idea that we should stick it to them, full throttle, go after the people who knowingly deceive and harm others. I'm talking about the believers, the kind of well-meaning, deceived. As skeptics, we should also admit that we're not always going to be on the side of right. They're not always going to be on the side of wrong. By this I mean we might be right in the sense of being correct, but wrong in about how we engage in skeptical activism. Sometimes our skepticism of some sorts of beliefs, right as that skepticism is in terms of the truth, is wrong-headed in terms of how it plays out. So most believers in whatever we're skeptical of, ghosts, God for some of us, alternative medicine, UFOs, crystal power, Bigfoot, chakras, therapeutic touch, homeopathy, any of that, believers dislike the confrontation some skeptics bring them precisely because of the kinds of beliefs they hold, the kinds of we'd say false beliefs. Randy's work, our work as skeptics, it often hits people right where they live and breathe. It's not trivial belief. It relates to the most basic and fundamental questions we can ask about ourselves, or about the universe, or about God or gods, or about our minds or our souls, the supernatural, even the meaning of life itself. Our skepticism touches on all of that really important set of issues that wake a lot of people up in the morning, keep a lot of people up at night. If psychic powers don't really exist, and that implies that souls don't exist outside their body, it may mean, I think it does mean, that the mind is what the brain does, and even implies that when you're dead, you're dead. Now, that's some heady stuff. That's not something we want to knock on door to door and say to people, hi, I'm a skeptic. Look at the implications of my skepticism. You want to join our movement. I think it explains why people are so resistant to our skeptical message. Now, I would never argue that we overdo trying to be understanding of the credulous or the faith heads, as Dawkins has referred to them, or the believers of woo, and that we eagerly accommodate every nonsense belief. That's not my position, but I'm just suggesting that we need to have both a tough mind as skeptics and a tender heart as humanists. Too much of a tough mind and you become a naysaying cynic rather than being a skeptic, which I consider to be an affirmative, a positive approach. Too much of a tough mind and you become kind of a hard-hearted, crotchety skeptic, and you ain't no fun. On the other hand, too much misplaced tender-heartedness without enough tough-mindedness, and you become lax about the truth and the harm that believing falsehoods may bring. In this way, just being right is not enough. You also have to be good. You have to be good about how you go about your skepticism. Obviously, this is kind of another topic and one that we'll address later in the day. So with that, I'll conclude my remarks. Thank you very much. And we have a couple minutes for questions. Thank you. Okay. So, thank you. I believe someone has a microphone, and so does anyone have a question? I guess since I can see the audience, just raise your hand if you have a question. Thanks for ringing up the house lights. Question right here. And unfortunately, we only have about 10 minutes for questions, so we'll do two or three. We may answer some more questions about the things I argued for a little later. Question.
Do you think that new atheism is zealotry?
Like all philosophers or people who play at philosophy, I'll answer yes and no, right? So it's complicated. I think... First, the atheists get a bad rap. I think there is some of the new atheism goes too far, but generally I think they get a bad rap. So here's the yes and no. I find Richard Dawkins to be deeply humane. He's genteel. He speaks the truth. He has values of truth versus falsehood that compel him to speak. But he also does it, I think, in a very considerate way. He's not... or at least as I've seen him engage. Now, I've seen him in a couple Q&As, and maybe it's after giving an hour and a half talk and you're a little tired. I don't know what it is, or maybe it's just because you want to be a great public speaker and rile people up. I've seen him be a little pointed, but generally I find him to be on the side of right. Hitchens, as a polemicist, is on the side of right. Now, I think, I don't want to really go down this road. There's not enough time in the Q&A, but I will say, there is room in the skeptics movement for many voices, in the rationalist movement, atheists, all of that. One question is that Dawkins et al., the new atheists, don't just have one of many voices. They have really big voices, gigantic megaphones. That said, as a gay man, I look at the history of the gay rights movement and I see a definite necessary place for the kind of extreme high heels throwing drag queens, right? And then the suit and tie, well, the suit wearing gays, you know, benefiting from that, but not throwing our high heels. My high heel only comes out, you know, 8 times a year. and I don't throw it. So I hope that gets at your question. Any other comments, questions?
I was wondering how you feel skepticism would work with cultural relativism. I saw Dawkins in one of his specials. He almost verbally attacked an Orthodox Jew in London. And you don't do that in New York. You don't do that in America, even though I'm having trouble admitting it now. I'm getting nervous. I see certain things, and especially immigrant religious communities, where the goal of it is to keep them centered, the in-group away from the out-group, and merely bringing science, critical thinking, or rationality into their life will destroy their worldview and would destroy their culture, not to mention what we would do if we were to bring science to places in, like, in the middle of nowhere, or, like, Africa.
I think I get the sense of your question. Cultural relativism, and you're not talking the ethics of cultural relativism and that some people have this view in that culture and this other view in that culture. I really hear you asking a question about strategy. And so anytime you're trying to persuade an audience, you have to know your audience. So one would be compelled to ask, was Dawkins' goal there to persuade the Orthodox Jews, the Hasidim, maybe, or was his goal to speak to other people about how nonsensical he thinks those beliefs over here are? I think this is a strategic question, and again, I think this is going to be one that we touch on during the one of the panels later on today. I think you have to know your audience, and a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, right? So we have time for a couple more questions.
Hi, yes. This is the same question that I asked last year, I believe. but how do
I love
you,
the persistence.
Yes. How do you not become a zealot? How do you not become angry when talking to people that are, frankly, espousing bull?
this may sound a little supercilious, but I think it's developmentally appropriate for a young new skeptic to be balls to the wall angry about nonsense, right? I think there's a maturation that comes in one's skepticism. When I first became a skeptic, look, I was for a number of years a fundamentalist Christian in an apocalyptic cult. I believed the end of the world was happening so soon that the church I was in didn't even buy real estate, right? The church I was in only rented. I am not kidding. And so when I had my deconversion experience in my late teens, man, I wanted to buttonhole everybody. My favorite pastime while I was at graduate school in Washington University was going in University City, which is the neighborhood right next to the school, and spending a Friday night. My idea of a good Friday night was standing on a street corner with my skeptics group members at the school, Washington University League of Freethinkers, WOLF for short. Our motto was be a wolf, not a sheep, right? Well, we loved engaging, going to the street preachers in University City and just butting heads. But at some point I said, is it enough, right? I thought about these strategy questions that we'll address later today. The way you avoid being a zealot is what I tried to finish up with, which is have the tough mind of a skeptic, but have the tender heart of a humanist. And don't get too lopsided in one direction or another. We have time for one more question, I think.
Question. Yes, I appreciate that you started by defining what you meant by skepticism, what you defined what humanism was. Words matter. And yet one of the words you didn't define that I wish we would as a group is common sense. We're very careful to point out that it's not appropriate to define people as idiots or believers, and yet the term common sense will often make people feel that same way.
Well, and more than that, common sense itself, many skeptics would argue when we're engaging what I call the Mensa effect, we'd argue that common sense is neither too common nor too sensible, right? So by common sense, let that be synonymous with critical thinking or the kick the tires mentality. You buy a car, kick the tires, look under the hood. In other words, it doesn't have to imply, by the term common sense, I was only suggesting it doesn't have to only apply to pseudoscience and the paranormal, that skepticism can have a broader purview. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your attention, and I look forward to continuing the conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, DJ. DJ Grothe, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank
President
you.
Of the JREF. I don't imagine DJ is new to most of you, but he always demonstrates that fresh and independent and reasonable mind and voice in the skeptical movement. It is no surprise he is a leading voice amongst us.